Good morning, everyone, and welcome once again to the ICA Cricket Show. I'm Satish Vishwanathan, and it's, as usual, my privilege to host the show brought to you by the Indian Cricketers Association. Our topic today is, of course, the ongoing India-England series, which some had predicted would be one-sided. But going to the fourth and penultimate test, the series is excitingly tied at 1-1. I mean, I don't think we would want it any other way. To discuss what went wrong in the Headingley test, and what needs to be done in the Oval Test that kicks off just a few hours from now, I'm pleased to welcome back on the show Yajuvendra Singh, fondly known as Sunny, a former Indian cricketer who's now director of the ICA while being a regular cricket columnist. Sunny, welcome back. We look forward to hearing from you.
Thanks, sir.
Also back is another former India and Karnataka player, Vijay Bharadwaj, who was with us for the preview of the series. Welcome, Vijay. I'm pleased to say that you are not one of those who predicted Indian domination. You said, you know, in fact, the first test you're talking about probably 60-40 to England. So welcome back.
Thanks, Satish.
Yeah. Joining them both is former Tamil Nadu left-arm spinner Sunil Subramanian, who just 2 weeks back on this very show gave us some very useful insights on this Indian team. Thanks to him having been the manager of the side earlier. So welcome back, Sunil. You are indeed wonders of an English fight back.
Thanks.
Gentlemen, while we'll later focus on the test coming up soon, we must begin by discussing, you know, what happened at Leeds. Bar for the toss, which Virat Kohli won, a very rare thing for him. Hardly anything went right for the Indians. That this performance followed the great win at Lord's has left many of us wondering. Sunny, can you put a handle on what happened?
If I was Kohli, I would say another bad day at work. But like he said, when we were all out for 36. So, I'll tell you, the English bowlers bowled extremely well. This is the sort of a time that one and a half, 2 hours. I think even England would have batted as well if they had won the toss. You need to go through in any match. I mean, both my cricket colleagues here also would tell you that it's that period, you know, the first 2 hours, that you need to somehow bat through. And unfortunately, the Indian batsmen faced some hostile bowling. And they were not being, this is sometimes, they're not being able to sort of technically get over it. I don't think they played badly. It was just that every time it got the edge, it went into, you know, in the keeper's hand or in the slips. So I really don't know how one can ever, get over this. But reason being, I'll tell you, this is the same thing which has been happening over years with even in England. As soon as we bowled well at Lord's, they were all at 120 runs. So, I mean, the same team later on gets runs against us. We have been out for 42 runs at Lord's. We have been out for 96 runs at Lord's. Even the last time in 2014, we were out for 105 at Lord's. So, I mean, it's something that when wickets are stumbling, somehow or the other, we are losing all teams. It's happening to all teams. They're all losing it together. And so I don't think there's anything massively wrong. It's just that one of those bad days. Yeah, that's like I could only put my finger to that.
Yeah, I agree, Sunny. I mean, we saw how they bounced back anyway in Australia. But Sunil, you did say England is a professional outfit. They'll come back hard at home. But did you expect this sort of capitulation from the Indians? Look, it's 78 out in the first innings. You know, we got caught on a wicket, which was, and I don't blame the toss part. Batting first is always an option. But it followed a loss of 8 wickets for 63 runs on day 4. Sunil, can it all be blamed simply on the Duke ball in English conditions?
It's not surprising. I told you on that show, I'm just surprised that the openers put on that partnership. Look, I've watched this team very closely. And I watched the way teams world over prepare when they prepare against us and how we play in domestic cricket. What's the kind of technique we have? See, we have a problem. It's not just about this team. See, the reason I'm a little critical of this team is because the moral stand they take, that nothing shakes them and things like that. I mean, the pattern is exactly what the teams of the past are, which is Asian teams struggle when the ball swings and seams. I don't see something new that is happening here. But the fact is, I have a feeling there's a bit of an ostrich in the sand there. See, I've seen it happen in Johannesburg, in the South Africa tour. I've seen it happen in England again and again. I've seen it happen in New Zealand. The pattern is pretty clear. When the ball starts to seam and swing, so we do need an element of luck, no doubt. But the modern day cricketer is a different beast. See, the challenges he has is the most formats he plays. He's bred in a T20 format.
True.
So the first instinct is to get out of the front foot, get runs. You know, go hard at the ball. The generation prior to, even the 2000 generation, was not bred on T20. See, they could find ways and means for the outreach, not for the ball not to get the outreach. It could mean a couple of sessions of looking a little, not settled down, you could say not comfortable. But somehow they could wait that session through. But this generation seems to, the patience to wait out time, it's quite limited. So minute they play a couple of shots, they're back to pushing at the ball, back to going towards the ball. So what that does is, it's consistently inviting edges, whether it's in Adelaide when we're 36 all out, whether it is now with 78, or the scores are immaterial, the grouping of balls. It could be, for example, it could be 105 for one and 120 all out later. It's a grouping of balls. When those grouping of balls are coming, there is an issue. There is an issue with the guys going at harder hands and their right foot not being able to precisely judge where the off stump is. And believe me, it's all being exposed by searching, probing, high-class bowling. Anything less than that, it can be dead. I've seen the way they practice in with throwdowns. I've seen the way they've got three guys bowling at 140, 150. So they practice really hard. The work ethic is great, but the ball doesn't move as much. But when you go onto the center, the ball does move. And I think with the kind of cricket these guys are bred on, you should be expecting this. But I still want a little more time to be spent in the middle by number 3, 4, 5, 6. That's what is bothering me. More than the runs, look at the number of overs. This is the first time in the last 2-odd years we have got to 100 overs on a seeming track. New Zealand, we batted 90-odd overs for 180 or something. I need the middle order, not the tail, to get us where it was, which was, you know, a glorious accident that happened, and surprising accident in Lords with all that, the needling work. But that's not what we're looking. 3, 4, 5, 6. I need them to bat at least 75 to 80 overs. Runs will come. Once they do that, once the champion side, they know how to get runs. They just need to stay in the wicket longer. And I think there is an issue. Tell those guys, bat about 75 to 80 overs. I won't be convinced. It's the same thing. It's nothing new that I'm watching.
Vijay, there are two things from takeaway from what Sunil also says. He's talking about the fact that they don't play enough deliveries. I remember on the first show, you said that it's not only batting number of deliveries, but also putting away in England because you're never in. No, they keep saying you're never in. So you have to put away those bad balls also. But if you look at Pujara, he showed two aspects. In the second innings of the earlier test, he blocked and, you know, sort of saved us. He played those number of balls that Sunil has been talking about. But similarly, in the first innings here in Headingley, he was an aggressive Pujara. With outscoring Rohit Sharma and etc. So which is the right approach? There's a second part of this question. And is there enough red ball of innings games that our test batsmen get to play? Okay, except for Pujara, you know, and Vihari maybe, who don't play the T20s and other things at the moment. Where is the first class cricket that these guys get to play? So is that a problem?
Satish, it's an eternal question. You know what? This been happening for years. Every time there's a debacle with the Indian team batting order, we talk about the domestic circuit, we talk about the conditions back at home. But look at the kind of experience these cricketers have. I'm not being too critical about the batting, but at the same time, they've got so much experience that they'll have to bear out every now and then. You can't go for a longer period without scoring 100 or probably without contributing much to the team's cause. Like what happened to Pujara, got a 90 odd then. And then he can't go without runs for the next 6 or 7 innings. I mean, the consistency is gone for a toss. I totally agree with Sunil Subham when he's saying that when the ball is moving during the game, they are finding it difficult. I know, you'll have to play the good balls out. That's the best part about test cricket. You just cannot expect something else. You can't expect mediocre bowling attack to come and bowl you out during the game. So that's exactly the thing which needs to be addressed at this point of time. See, playing at 140, 150 with a side armor is fair enough. They play fast bowling really well. But when it comes to the kind of accuracy they have been put against, the ball moving around in England, then that becomes a big challenge. I'm very critical about Pujara's technique. You cannot say that I'm like this. I'll play my cricket the way I know. if you cannot tweak and adjust, probably you don't have to challenge the conditions. Probably you'll have to adapt to the conditions and then get on top of it. Tell me how many innings Pujara has got runs in England consistently. The way Rohit Sharma has adapted, the way Rahul has batted. I know there will be difficult conditions to counter, but at the same time, these are club standards, not club standards, they are test standards, they are gold standards. So I expect Ajinkya Rahane, Pujara to get runs at least every now and then, if not all the games. The same thing has been with Virat Kohli. The kind of series he had in 2018 was a totally different thing. He also had some luck going his way. Initial balls, I'm saying. Yeah, but once he got set, the kind of innings he played was fantastic. So you cannot stay there. Look at the kind of lessons which we can learn from Joe Root. The kind of innings he has played is brilliant. He paces his innings very well. He knows when to leave the ball, when to attack, what kind of shots going to fetch the runs. So that's the kind of preparation, I think, which is lacking at this point of time with the Indian batting lineup. Same thing happened in New Zealand. Same thing happened in Adelaide. But they have bounced back. I'm saying the individual brilliance got them going. But it's not a total team effort when it comes to batting order. Fab Four also have struggled. I'm talking about Sachin, Lakshman, Rahul, Ganguly, Sehwag. They also struggled in England. But look at the kind of approach this Indian team has. They say nothing is wrong. Accepting the fact that there is something wrong, we'll have to address it. That's the first step towards development, Satish.
Sunil, you were trying to say something?
Let me put it in perspective. See, I'm somebody who watches a lot of cricket. You believe me, you have been watching cricket from 1936 videos, old videos, right till present day cricket. And I watch a lot of videos of matches in England. We're talking. And from 1936 onwards, I've noticed the technique of all Indian batsmen. In fact, Asian batsmen. There are two who come to my mind over time. I may be very ruthless in this, who come to my mind, who have really flowered when the ball moves. Zaheer Abbas, Rahul Dravid. See, Sachin was God, but believe me, if you brutally analyze the technique of these two people, they are the ones who really looked, nobody is comfortable at home in those conditions. And I'll tell you why. It strikes me, because I've been looking at the English players, right from Ted Dexter, Peter May, right down to Graham Gooch, to Michael Atherton, down. See, if you look at the most successful English players, who was the threat of the new ball? Biggest threat is the opening batsman, right? So what's the opening batsman? What is their technique? You look at Michael Atherton. You look at Joe Root. You look at Geoffrey Boycott. Just see where their first 30, 40 runs are. They are never straight of the wicket. Most of them are playing late, on the back foot, soft hands, between extra cover and third man. That is where their most runs are. Which is what? Allowing the, and these are homebred champions. There's a lesson to be learned there. What Asian teams are doing is, once we, especially right now, these days, once we middle a few, we are immediately looking to up the ante and get onto the front foot. So that's like being sucked, you know, it's like when you're just being sucked into what these guys are doing. Whereas ever since, listen, today we are talking Duke balls. We were then having read a ball, but please don't forget they played on uncovered wickets. It's a different beast altogether. And uncovered wickets test techniques like nothing the modern era has seen.
Yeah, right?
So they had a beast to deal with. Even they played there. Yeah. Right? Correct. This is, and I'm saying the first 10, 20 minutes, then you get your game going. But that is when you require the most amount of luck and application. They all played from point to third man. They played late. I don't see this many runs initially going with this team. They are looking to up the ante. They're looking to get onto the front foot at the smallest hint of middling of you. That's where the bat goes up.
Satish, sorry to bother you. No, sorry to interrupt. You know, the first advice people give you when you tour England, no? They said, get onto the front foot. In fact, that's the last thing you should be doing. If you watch Rohane and Pujara play closely, very closely, they hardly play on the back foot. The moment they go on the back foot, they get a lot of runs. The range opens up. The moment you come on the front foot, your range is stuck. You're only between mid-off covers and into the slips. So the moment you start to play straighter, you're in for trouble. It's like playing on a turning track. You can't play straight on a turning track. That's the same theology. Mm. And when you say that, as close to the body as possible. Virat Kohli is pushing at the ball. Rishabh Pant is playing almost like 1.5-2 feet away from his body. If you think that's the way he's going to play, he's not going to survive. Maybe one innings in 10 innings. Is that the consistency that you're looking at? Sometimes I don't agree with people saying, you just leave him, he's a genius. Bro, you just have to adapt. You just have to tweak your thing. Adapt to the conditions or probably get the percentage going. Which is the best shot? Where to play the runs? Where how to play the bowlers? Think on those lines. I'm sure they would have discussed it. But if the same mistakes have been repeated right now, I don't think they're going to be bailing out. I agree with Sunil Subha when I say that Rahul Dravid was one of the best exponents of playing swing bowling. You hardly see him, Nick. He was the best lever of the ball. I agree totally. But he also knew how to score runs on those kind of wickets. Headingley was a perfect example. Ole was a brilliant. You can count the number of innings.
This is what will happen. Wickets will fall in a heap. If they do this, it will fall in a heap. Otherwise, you can delay, you can postpone the heap. A couple of partnerships, then it won't fall in a heap. But if you want to play the same manner, it's the same distance.
I'm sure Richie will say something, sorry.
Yeah, of course. When you talk about 1936 and all that, you have to think of the great guys, yeah, like Vijay Merchant, you've forgotten. Vijay Hazare, you've forgotten. Sunil Gavaskar. I mean, I'll tell you, the way he used to adapt to play in English conditions. So, I mean, there are going to be people who are capable of adapting and playing late. I agree with you, Sunil. It has to be. You have to play late there. When I played over there, I played, like you said, you don't commit yourself to playing off the front foot or off the back foot. Your legs have to be, you have to judge length. And that's where most batsmen are getting. I think the chap who could judge length the best, I'm sorry to say, is Sunil Gavaskar. And he is miles ahead of everyone else. If it was a short ball, he was playing back foot. If it was an overpitch ball, he was in the front foot. Tendulkar never did it. And a lot of the other guys have not done it. Is because, like you said, there are various other formats. The bats have become different. The whole idea of batting has changed. But judging length was a very important factor. And this is where I find most of our batsmen are falling. See, if you see, whether it's Virat Kohli or such, a short ball, they are still on the front foot. You're definitely right that somebody feels comfortable on the front foot, which is something, a technique which has done well for them in India and elsewhere also. So now let's say at oval, the wicket is going, the weather is, I think, going to be sunny most of the days. That's what we have predicted. On a sunny day in England, you can put your leg front or back, makes no difference. Ball will come slow, ball will come easy. And you can have a great innings just playing that. And who showed us this was Rahul. If you're KL Rahul, when he got that 149 whatever at the Oval, when it was a lovely sunny day, he batted brilliantly. And a lot of people have been able to do that, you know, adapt it. Rangsakar has done that when the sun has been great. He's got a lot of runs because it becomes that much easier. And especially at the Oval, it does. But what has happened with England is now they have two bowlers. I mean, Anderson, we are not even counting. He's a great bowler. But the other two bowlers who are accompanying him are bowling not great. They're not bowling very fast. But they are bowling very accurately. And they're bowling on the corridor. And corridor, once you bowl consistently there, it becomes much easier it becomes very difficult for a batsman to encounter. I think basically then you're finding people trying to stay outside the crease. And those outside the crease is when the ball is moving in the air. You know, it's not when the ball moves off the wicket.
Very true.
Because
yeah.
Then the ball comes that much faster to you. You know, the more chances of you edging it. It's when it's moving in the air, not moving off the wicket. Now, somebody like Mohinder Ramanath did extremely well against Imran Khan in Pakistan, when the ball was moving, you know, at that time. But that was moving in the air, not off the wicket. So he used that same tactic of standing ahead or playing on the front foot. And that is where people are judging the length and doing all these adaptations for no rhyme or reason also can become quite detrimental. And I think those are the factors that are all relating to their failures. You know?
Okay. See, there's one thing. Different eras are played differently. What Sunny said is right. Now, I have a suggestion. Each era will adapt to its own technique. We have one center in India called Lali. Why don't we make it a permanent NCAA venue where you play swing bowling? Nothing moves like the ball moves at Lali anywhere in India. So get accustomed to that condition. Send your youngsters there, right from the under 15. Make that a center where you play swing bowling. I'm sure they'll find their ways and means to get comfortable in those environments. Lali is a place where they should explore.
Yeah, Sunil, the issue is, you know, our tours are arranged these days in such a way that even if you want to have a camp, for example, before a tour of England, you go to Lali. Or somewhere else, if you go to Australia, then go to Mohali.
Well, not before your tour. Not before your tour. You plan ahead from under 13, 14, 15 onwards. Start now.
Okay. So have one center there. Okay. I think...
Have a center there.
Sunil, I see a board meeting. Yeah. Talk this and then.
Yeah, correct. No, I think the new academy that they want in Bangalore, in your place, where they want to do it, they want to give different type of wickets and different conditions or whatever they want to try and formulate something like that. I agree with you. It has to happen when you're young, and I think that is important. And you have to get the right guys to tutor them in that. Yeah. That's a very important factor, you know, because you can't just say, you know, just send them there and say, try and play it, and they fail and they lose their confidence and they forget what they can anyway do also. You know, you have to also make sure.
Hey, get the best coaches.
The originality.
Yeah, get the best coaches. Let them be themselves. Let them be in the environment from the age of 14. Send them there. You see, a difference will come about in 5 years' time. I'm sure. Even if you get the odd, you won't get a perfect world. You won't get the best coaches all the time. You'll get the odd rotten apple. Fine. But the guys will see through it. They'll get adapted to a condition where once they go there, they're not searching for answers on tour.
I'll give you one example. I'm just sorry, I'll say I don't want to take too much time. Sure. My room partner in the England tour in 79 was Sunil Gavaskar. And I was not getting a chance to play, and I finally played at the Oval in the last test match. But all throughout, he kept on telling me, Sunny, just practice one thing. Go across you go so that you know where your off stump is with that leg. Just a little across so that you know where your off stump is. And then move your left leg, if it's over pitch or short pitch or whatever, but move your left leg, has to move quickly enough, and you know where your off stump is. Now you know where your leg stump is, so in that movement you have already organized where your stumps are. And he made me practice this in front of a mirror every morning, and I was saying, why you know you're more than a house master type of a chap here. I just think, but when I got a chance to play, and it was all these exactly this sort of conditions, and Hendrik was bowling extremely well. This is the technique which did very well for me. So that's why I'm saying you have to be, somebody has to advise you and be able to, then you need to adapt it. And he made me practice it in front of a mirror every day, 100 times in front of the mirror. And he would say, you have not done your practice. And it was not taking a ball, not making someone throw balls at 150 miles an hour or whatever this, that. It was just 150 kilometers, sorry. It was just practicing, basically watching yourself. Am I doing the right thing? And it proved right for me. Now, whether this technique worked when I came back to India is a separate issue. But it worked brilliantly in England. And that's why we need players who have done well, like you said, Rahul Dravid, Sunil Gavaskar. These are people who need to actually study and help these guys if they want help. If they want help, but they're there. I'm sure they will be the right people to approach and talk to. Sorry to take so much of your time.
No issues, Sunny. That, you know, it's fair enough. I mean, you've got to work on particular things. This is the small things that, you know, you correct. That's how you, because during a series, you're not going to make any big changes. But, you know, the one thing that you, if you look at it, this England attack, they don't even have the Jofra Archer, Stuart Broad and Singh. So this is, well, we're actually, apart from Anderson, we're facing a second string attack. But okay, moving on. You know, we got two tests to go. A few hours from now, I said the Oval test is coming up. Series very much wide open. You know, keeping with this feet movement, etc., etc., there's one particular thing which I want to talk to you about, is that you mentioned his name earlier, Rishabh Pant. Now, I believe that after his exploits in Australia, in India, and the way he's keeping has improved. I mean, he's a far improved wicket keeper. today. He's possibly your number one wicketkeeper batsman in the Test 11 at the moment. He's moved ahead of Saha. But is this number six, and we will obviously come to the entire combination very shortly, but is number six one step to one position too high? I mean, you look at Rishabh Pant's scores, 25, 37, 22, 2 and 1, and it's a number six. So is that one step too high, Vijay? Will it help if he comes, say, seven?
Always been the case, Satish. Not batsman at number seven makes a lot of difference. Someone like Gilchrist did that for Australia. So Rishabh Pant is very similar. You can't compare Rishabh Pant with Gilchrist, obviously, but he's still a long way to go. But at number seven, Rishabh Pant makes a lot of difference. He can win matches. I agree with that. No doubt about it. But you need a batsman at number six. See, the combination goes for a toss because you're missing an all-rounder who can bat. A batting all-rounder who can bowl, I'm saying. Someone like Hardik Pandya or any batsman for that matter, if you have at number six, no, that gives a lot of strength to the batting unit. And Virat Kohli went on record saying that if six batsmen can't do the job, how do you expect the seventh one? That's a vague kind of a statement if you ask me. Your seventh batsman can make a lot of difference. So I feel if you can get a number six proper batsman and then have Rishabh Pant at number seven, that will be a great thing for Indian cricket. So having said that, we have two all-rounders. I consider Ashwin as an all-rounder. I mean, sorry for that. Because you cannot leave Ashwin out, Satish. Whatever may be the conditions, Australia, England, you name the conditions, he has to be there. So the combination revolves around these three gentlemen, Ravindra Jadeja, Ashwin and Rishabh Pant. So you'll have to decide where Rishabh Pant bats. At six means you only have five proper batsmen. I'm not saying Rishabh Pant is not a proper batsman, but look at the consistency. You can't depend upon him. You can win matches. He's a maverick, no doubt about it. But can you trust him and then say, put your money on him? No. And I mean, that's the case with Rishabh Pant. The consistency gives you trust. I mean, if you are a management guy, you'll know that if he's able to convert the 30s, 40s into 60s, 70s, at least once in three innings, then the trust will build. Rishabh Pant has not given you. He's given you two brilliant innings, one victory in Gabba, one in Oval probably, one in Sydney. But where is the consistency? If that happens, no, I feel that will be a great thing for Rishabh Pant. I want people like Rishabh Pant to be there in the team, Satish.
Yeah, I mean, he got 100 at the Oval last time they played there. So,
when you talk about Rishabh Pant at six, the reason that poor chap is also getting exposed is because the others are not doing too well. And he's getting exposed much earlier than what he would normally have been. So, but he's a very gifted player, like we all said. He needs to understand his game. He cannot just go wild. You know, he just cannot go. He has to understand the situation as well. And I think that's where he's still immature. He's totally immature as a batsman. He's gifted. Tremendous timing and stroke play. It's only that he has to use it at the right time. So I think because he's coming in much earlier, that he's finding this a problem. I don't think six or seven would make that much of a difference. But I agree with Bhardwaj totally. I think both, we cannot do without Ashwin and definitely Jadeja. I think this time we are going to play both the spinners, and that would be an ideal combination basically for an Indian side.
See, cut a long story short, with the kind of vision that Virat has got, it requires five bowlers. This is where we miss a genuine all rounder or close to a genuine swing seam bowling all rounder. You had Hardik Pandya on your team, it solves your problem. In the absence of that, one of the guys is going to get a raw deal and sad it is Ash. Ash should have played. But that will always be the case. Now, number six, what are the West Indies great teams doing? They're back to six and five bowlers. I don't see a problem with that. The top six, top five have to get runs. But if you don't have a seeming all-rounder, then this is a quick fix that one has to keep going match to match. You'll have to see what is the condition available. That will always be up for debate. There'll be two sides to it. Maybe would you have gone with four bowlers and seven batsmen? Of five bowlers and six batsmen, simply because you don't have a seam bowling all rounder. That's the end of it. I just hope this match we should be able to look at a three fast bowler, two spinner combo, because both the spinners are not just spinners; they're pretty handy with the bat. But let's see if they're looking on those in that direction.
But the issue here is, Satish, two people are struggling, Rahane and Pujara. That is putting a lot of pressure on the batting unit. So obviously, your team is as good as your weakest link. So at this point of time, Pujara's and then Rahane's form is the weakest link for the Indian team. If those two people bat differently or probably contribute to the team's cause a lot more at a very good pace, consistently, then this debate doesn't come up all.
Yes, let's see. You can't drop either of them. As of now, I think there'll be one more chance given. In an ideal world, if you're as brutal to Ashwin, let's put it this way, then you should be brutal to the others.
Same rule applies for them.
Say, boss, Pujara or Rahane, one of you drop, either SK, Surya or Vihari plays. But if the understanding is right, these guys need to be given that one last chance. This will possibly be the last chance for this batting. Let's hope they come good.
Pujara has just got 91 runs in the second inning and he batted extremely well. I mean, that is asking for somebody to, I don't think that is. And Rahane has somehow always performed when we need them at certain areas.
None of them have performed really well overseas. He got
61, which gave us a victory just a test match before. So I think we're being too harsh on these people. I understand you have to have the consistency, and I've been writing on that as well.
They can be harsh to Ash, a world-class guy. What's stopping from being harsh to the others?
But who are you going to put in there?
Let's look at it slightly differently. Yeah. You're talking.
Okay, look at Surya Kumar Yadav.
On what grounds? I mean, that fellow is not just
should be Bihari first.
Fair enough.
You want to throw somebody to the bulls, they are just immediately.
No, guys.
We are one all. We need to play our best side to get ahead. Just cannot take a
I'm just giving a point of view. Sunia Khan, the other but if I'm doing the job. Well,
you know?
No, gentlemen, let me.
No, I'm giving a point of view, but if I'm there in the hot seat, I won't change the batting right now. I'll play with this team. The bowling combo, I hope we look at a 3-2. We look at a 3-2, we'll play three medium bases, two spinners. But both spinners can bat.
So let me ask you guys a question. We are talking about English conditions where the ball does a lot, the bowler is always in command, bowler always stands a chance, and a bowler has got six balls every over, you know, to do his stuff. You just need 10 wicket-taking balls across an innings. In these kind of conditions, and we keep seeing batsmen are not in, where is the about five bowlers? Why this argument for five bowlers? I can understand. Even in Australia, in Brisbane, for example, you'd keep pounding away. The wicket only breaks on the fourth day. Something like, you know, a lot of different kind of West Indies, many of the centers, the bowlers need, you know, to really work hard. England, you don't need to work that hard as a bowler. You've got many more chances than a batsman. So my take is not about dropping either Rahane or Pujara at this point, because they have each scored in one innings, and it's okay. Not very consistent is what you expect of them. But I'm saying add a sixth batsman by pushing Rishabh to seven. The sixth batsman should be Vihari. If that is the case, and my further call is that it should be Ashwin at eight in this test match, because we've tried Jadeja. We are not talking about, we can't call him the elephant of the room. We should talk about the king in the room. This is Joe Root. We are not able to get him out. Four bowlers, five bowlers, six bowlers, not able to get him out. Is Ashwin the answer to Root? Will he be the man to get him? Is it worth taking the chance against a batsman in such form? So my question to all three of you is six batsmen plus Pant, then Ashwin and three pacers, because we are playing in England.
Satish, I'll answer that. If the minute you start talking about Vihari, I'll tell you what will be the mindset. Vihari can give you 10 overs of off-spin. The first axe will follow Ashwin. In which case, you will have seven batsmen, including Vihari, four bowlers. They'll go in with three and Jaddu, because one guy bowls off-spin. This is my fear. See, this the way Virat has led is he's led. He's captaining. He's the boss. He's led with this five combo. I'm all with it. You can win with four bowlers too. Four wicket-taking bowlers. Yep. But if you go by that premise that your best bowlers have to play, then Ash should have been playing from the first test. He's your best spinner. But that is not quite. The thinking here is the attacking job is to be done by the fast bowlers. So get your sharpest three or four guys. We'll manage with the spinner. Right? That's the thinking. But once you get Vihari into it, again, it will be the case where we'll have, okay, Vihari can do a job. Vihari can bowl those 10 overs, 15 overs. Jan can work, he's there for left-arm spin, and you have three medium paces. That would be the thinking. Would they go? Actually, they can go. Simply, the only reason why they can go with two off-spinners is there are 4 to 5 left-handers in this team. So it's not a big ask if two offies were to play. But would they take the call? We've got to wait and see.
No, I mean, Vihari, as a bowler, they should consider him as a bowler. He should purely as a number 6 batsman.
Last time in over, he got 2 wickets in no time. Huh?
No. If he gets to bowl, fine. But the 4 bowlers are Ash and 3 pacers. That is my theory. Because again, I go back to the fact that we are playing in England. In England, you do not need 5 bowlers. It's my take right from the first. It's the first, four, your top 4 bowlers. Whether they are 4 pacers and you're playing. That's why I said when they play Jadeja, they're playing him more over rate and as a batsman. Right. But he's been doing well, good enough as a batsman. Vijay, what do you say?
Satish, can I come in?
Yeah.
I'll tell you, when you say 4 bowlers, I've seen a lot of teams suffer. Even if one bowler gets injured, you know, 4 bowlers, because see, we are playing a test match. There's 20 wickets we have to get. Yeah. And at the oval, sometimes the wicket becomes extremely good and it becomes very tiring. It happened to us when we chased 438, we nearly chased 438 runs in the second innings. It was because Hendrick broke down. And then they had only 4 bowlers to counter. And that's when the problems come about. A lot of teams have suffered when one bowler has... I think we had the same situation, Lords, during Dhoni's time, when he went in and bowled also. And these are things that you cannot in a test match go without 5 frontline bowlers. Because you need to get 20 wickets. Who cares if somebody gets 100 runs or 150 runs as a batsman? Then you're going in for a draw. If you're going for aggression, you're going to win. You have to go with you have to get 20 wickets. Without getting those 20 wickets, you can't win any test match. So that is where Virat Kohli is very much onto this 5-bowler thing. And whether you have 2 spinners and 3 fast bowlers, but he needs 5 bowlers. That is it. And he needs the rest of them to score. If you don't score, then you cannot... it's not tall scoring matches. Normally, England is about 250, 275 also at times are okay. So let's not get ourselves too much into 4 bowlers. 4 bowlers, one chap drops out. Oh, it's bonanza for the other team to score runs after that.
This is where we miss the bowling all-rounder. This is exactly where we miss it.
No, I agree. I agree with you because Hardik Pandya is not there and there's nobody else. In domestic cricket, I mean, you all follow it much better and you're very close to it. But I don't see anybody else of even that Hardik standard, you know, which is coming about. It's a sad situation where India is concerned. Because you need a medium pacer. You need it in South Africa. You need it in Australia. You need it in England. You need it in New Zealand. You need somebody to be there, at least who can bat and bowl. And unfortunately, I have not seen anybody in the Indian outlook.
That's quite true. We've got to do with what we have. 3 and 2. Let's look at the combo. Let's hope it's a balanced combo.
Yeah, Vijay?
Correct.
Yeah, Satish, initially...
I feel sorry for Akshar Patel also, poor chap. He's done so well in India. And he's watching the test matches sitting in England. So, I mean, there's also a chance maybe he should be given a chance as well. But I don't know. Jadeja is doing so well and he's batting extremely well. I think the two people who have really adapted well to those conditions are Rohit Sharma and Ravindra Jadeja, where their batting is concerned.
Okay.
Satish, when you fill in the 11, no? You have to be very sure that these guys are going to deliver. Whether they deliver or not, that's a different question. But at least when you fill in the 11, you should not be having any doubts. Maybe he will deliver. Maybe he will score. You can't go with an expectation saying that they will perform. So at this point of time, even though we are missing Hardik Pandya, I think that slot can be given to Ravindra Jadeja. For the last 1.5 years, he's done well. So you need to have 5 bowlers with Rishabh Pant at number 6. So that puts a lot of onus on the batting unit. They'll have to take up the responsibility. Having said that, responsibility is a big word to say. But the need of the hour is that they'll have to bat well to win games. If you don't have score on the board, what will the bowlers do? I'm not saying that they're consistently getting out at 70, 80. But if they can score 400 runs, give these kind of bowlers Ashwin, Jadeja, and three fast bowlers. That will be a great batting unit. Having said
400 that, balance want, Vijay, on these conditions, 275 to 350, get 300. That is good enough.
Both innings together.
Get to that. Get to that. Get to 280 to 320, 330. More than enough.
Subha, both innings together, Subha.
That is what is happening now.
Okay. Yeah, I remember, you know, people like Anil and Sri, Srinath, used to always tell me on tours when they go abroad, they used to tell me in Kannada, 300 odilappa, 300. Then you talk to us, you keep firing us.
Satish, when we didn't have four bowlers, we were cribbing that we don't have enough bowlers. Now we have a bunch of bowlers. So,
there are lot of
options in the bowling unit.
That is going to be my question. Shardul, we are talking about Bhartiya Pandya not being there and all that. So does Shardul, is he a sort of fit in there in that position?
That's a four bowler. If you look at that, it's going to be four fast bowlers. Four fast bowlers alone, obviously, he'll fit in. If you're looking at three fast bowlers, it'll be Bumrah, Shami, and Siraj, and Ashwin and Jadeja. If you're looking at the fourth fast bowler, it has to be Shami. It has to be this guy, Shardul.
With his, obviously, he's got some batting ability, and he's definitely not a bad bowler. He can move the ball around, which is what the English conditions are all about. And he went out of the ninja.
Indian batting ability, mat bolo yaar. Let's see what let them go their prime job, which is to get wickets. Let's see.
Don't forget the WhatsApp chat going on earlier, Sunil. We need 11 medium paces so that we can bolster our batting in the next test.
We definitely require. Satish, we require.
Hang on now. Now, listen. I don't think Manchester will have a full game. I've seen the weather report. Manchester weather report. 3 days of massive rains. So, London, this is fine. Manchester is going. The weather report is really poor. So, I don't think you'll have a full game. Yeah, London is fine. Yeah, all the 5 days look fine.
So, we need to go ahead in this particular match.
But where we lost the test match is when the English batsmen, the openers, both of who I think are technically so unsound, got runs against our bowlers. You know, I couldn't believe that. That partnership itself must have shocked India, you know, because they both are not. Batsmen should have been getting the sort of attack England in that condition, and why our bowlers couldn't move the ball as much.
Let's look at what's happened.
Maybe the ball needed to be changed, but I think that England batting is still weak. We are root.
Some issue with your line, Sami.
See, look at we played 13 games in Oval and 9 games in Manchester. India so far. You look at history from 2000 onwards. We lost 3 test matches in Oval. We lost the only one we played in Manchester. So, we really will have to create history. Only one victory in 13 plus 9, 22 games in these two places. Our best chance lies only in Oval. We have to create history here to level the series. That's what we are facing.
No, if we win this test, we can in Manchester with the weather being such that we can win the series. I mean,
this is it. Focus. This match is it. You're over again.
Okay, gentlemen, with that, I think we've come to the end of the show. It's going to be, I'm very, very looking forward to 3:30 p.m. 3 p.m. first of all, because I don't know. But is the toss going to be that relevant here? I don't know. They're also talking about grass on the pitch and things like that. So we'll have to figure out first, see when the pitch comes into view. We'll have to see how the pitch looks like. So anything on the toss? Any particular calls you would like to make, Vijay?
I think they should bat. Even though they had a debacle in the previous game, they should forget it and then just learn from it, move on. And if the condition is really good, if it's very sunny or probably if the wicket has got not that much of grass, then I think they should bat first. They should back themselves to bat first.
Reports are there is grass. I think it will be a good toss to lose.
If there is grass, the only condition is if there is grass.
It will be a good toss to lose.
Because that's what Bharat Tarun has said yesterday in the press conference, that he's waiting on the combo.
He said Ashwin could have figured, but there seems to be a lot of grass on these.
I think we should wait till the ground is handed over to the officials. Only then we will know how much grass is there.
This is where last, from 2014 onwards, they've consistently left 8 mm to 13 mm grass. So you are going to get only in that range. It's not going to be shaved off too much.
Yeah.
This is the pattern. So that's what you're going to get. So if it is that, I think it's a great toss to lose. Let them make the decision.
If there is grass, then their combination also will not have two spinners. I think they'll get a shot.
We'll go with Fovam, absolutely.
Yeah.
All right.
Let's wait and see.
Okay, gentlemen, let's wait and see. That's the word from this panel. Thank you both so much. I think Sunny's line went off. Not sure what exactly happened. Thank you very much.
Thanks, Satish. Thanks, Sunil.
Thank the audience.
Thanks, gentlemen. Thanks for calling again.
Yep, people are watching us also. Thank you very much.
Thanks,
Ankita. Thank you, everybody. Have a good test. Whatever happens, let's just enjoy the cricket.
Good to see you with your beard, Vijay.
Thanks, Sunil. Okay, bye.
Right, guys. Bye-bye.